Buongiorno a tutti e benvenuti a questo primo incontro del nostro ciclo di seminari sulla tecnologia applicata alle scienze filologiche librarie. Buongiorno ai nostri primi ospiti di questo ciclo, Liv Bateur e Henrik Hameur dell'Università di Lovanio, in Belgio. Il nostro primo incontro verterà sulla tecnologia applicata in particolar modo alla scansione del manoscritto del libro antico, e cioè una tecnologia che si chiama Reflectance Transformation Imaging, di cui ci parleranno oggi ampiamente la professoressa Bateur e il dottor Hameur. In particolare, appunto, anche lo sviluppo, si parlerà oggi dello sviluppo di una strumentazione che è stata che è partita proprio, diciamo, dall'Università di Lovanio, e cioè del cosiddetto microdome, uno strumento che permette appunto l'acquisizione di immagini con l'utilizzo di questa tecnologia particolare. Il microdome è stato abbiamo avuto la fortuna di vederlo in azione a Napoli, alla biblioteca di Girolamini, l'anno scorso, in occasione del biennio precedente della scuola di alta formazione, e vi presento in particolare, appunto, vi offrirò qui un piccolo profilo dei nostri relatori. La professoressa Bateur è membro della Facoltà di Teologia dell'Università di Lovanio, è una storica dell'arte e insieme una conservatrice, quindi unisce i due aspetti, diciamo, di ricercatrice e di conservatrice di manoscritti, ed è a capo del Book Heritage Lab dell'Università di Lovanio. Ha iniziato appunto lo sviluppo nel 2012 del microdome, l'applicazione di questo strumento su manoscritti e su tutto quello che ha a che fare con cultural heritage. È coordinatrice appunto di diversi progetti di ricerca che hanno a che fare con la miniatura, i manoscritti, i papiri e supporti scrittori come la carta e la pergamena. Quindi potete immaginare come può essere tutto quanto può essere utile e pertinente con il nostro ciclo di seminari. Dottor Hendrik Hameur è ricercatore ugualmente all'Università di Lovanio, nel Dipartimento di Storia Antica, ed è affiliato con i Musei Reali di Arte e di Storia di Bruxelles e con il Dipartimento di Archeologia dell'Università di Ghent. Si è laureato in archeologia e in assirologia e appunto subito dopo la sua formazione superiore si è specializzato in queste nuove tecniche di imaging, di digital imaging, per fini appunto culturali e archeologici. All'Università di Lovanio, in collaborazione con il laboratorio di ingegneria si chiama ESAT, ed è stato appunto implicato nello sviluppo di sistemi appunto legati al cosiddetto PLD, cioè Portable Light Dome, e quindi anche nello sviluppo del microdome. Ora, senza perdere tempo ulteriore, ringrazio appunto tutti i partecipanti, tutti, diciamo, gli studenti del corso, del corso di alta formazione della Scuola Superiore Meridionale, i dottorandi del Dipartimento di Studi Umanistici e anche tutti i partecipanti esterni che hanno deciso appunto di seguire il seminario e questo ciclo di lezioni. Do la parola a I give the word to leave now because and so if you can share your screen to begin. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Greetings from Belgium. So we are here this morning, Hendrik and I, and we'll give you an introduction to the portable light dome. We regret we cannot bring it to you to Naples, but it will be for another time. You see here on the first image a take from one of our projects. It's a Bruegel print under the micro dome. Yeah, do you see the next slide?
Yes.
Yes. So that's the university library in Leuven. It's a very old university. We are 600 years old. The library is more recent because it was bombed during the World War. So it's a building from the 50s, but it's very beautiful collections we are keeping there. Very large collections of manuscripts, early printed books. It's in that building, in fact, we are developing the project of the microdome. It started, and we will give you an introduction about the system, but we started about 10 years ago of working with it. First, it was the archaeologists who worked with it, and then we adapted it to research graphic documents. Graphic documents as manuscripts, papyrus, drawings, printed material, but also seals, everything that is kept in libraries, in archival collections, in museum collections. So we're really working on very different materials. We are working in a very interdisciplinary setup. It means we are collaborating with archivists, but also with chemists, with researchers, in biology. So it's a kind of approach towards the materiality of objects. We want to research their condition. We want to research how they are made. And for that, the microdome was an excellent tool because we could combine visual assessment with certain ways of looking to documents that are not possible with the naked eye. So it's a combination of engineering and a historical book archaeological approach. Some things we can see, some things we cannot see with the microdome, and it's very clear that if we cannot do it with the white light or the multispectral microdome, there are other ways in the lab to make that approach. So the microdome, it's a cupola, it's a half cupola with lightning in it. And we have two setups. We have a white light microdome, and then we have the multispectral microdome. It's very clear that there are different tools. Some things they can do together, some things are the white light microdome is stronger in. So we can document and visualize the topography of the surface, paper, parchment, like blind ruling, the thickness of the paint layers. We can look to it and we can use the images to as a researcher, and that's the end product, to discover all these characteristics. With the multispectral microdome, we are combining the multispectral imaging with the photometric stereo that is involved in the microdome. So they are different tools and they are quite quick, that you will see in the demo. They are quick. You have very fast results, and as a researcher or as a conservator, you can use the images to discover characteristics in your lab at home or in at the university to go further. So our presentation of this morning has different parts. So I give the word to Hendrik. We go into the multi-light reflexive technology. So what's how it's made? That's the part of the engineering. Then we will show you some examples with the white light portable light dome system, so that's PLD, portable light dome system. Then we will give examples with the multispectral microdome system. Then we have a presentation who is recorded on the new Pixel Plus viewer, and I think you already got the link. And then at the end, we will give you a live demo of the Pixel Plus viewer of one of the very interesting manuscripts we have from Naples, and it's kept on the in the university library. That's the Bible of Anjou. So, Hendrik?
Yes. Okay, thank you, Lieve, for the introduction. So we will first in this presentation have a look at, when we speak about multi-light reflectance technology, what is that technology about, how does it work, and also to see it in a wider scope. And we will see that the system we have developed in Leuven, and where this talk is in principle all about, is how we have been using multi-light reflectance technology for book heritage or flat heritage media. First, some facts on the system we have developed in Leuven for this purpose. We call it multi-light reflectance, but if you go and have a look into publications, sometimes it also has other different kind of names, this technology. It has not yet been established worldwide how exactly this technology should be called, but we mostly call it multi-light, so we will use many different light sources, and we work with the reflectance, so the reflection of those lights who are casted on a surface. It is very interesting to state that it is one of the most detailed and accurate interactive imaging systems there is. So we will, as a result, we will have images which are pixel-based. And for every pixel, we will have different kinds of information. In a normal picture, the only information is a color value for that pixel. Well, in the case of this kind of technology, we have a lot more information per pixel, which makes it possible to have to consult and to document a heritage object in much greater detail. Very important also about this system is that it is transportable. As the introduction has already mentioned, we already came to Naples a year ago. We already made images with our system in Naples, and that is very important, of course. You can have a very good system, but if it is not transportable, you can't go to the actual collections where the heritage objects are. It becomes a limitation, and we didn't want that that limitation. At the end, it creates 2D and 3D models, and then very important also, as already has been mentioned, we actually have two systems, one with white light, so with visual light, the kind of light that the humans human eye can see, but we also have a multispectral system where we divide infrared, red, green, blue, and ultraviolet lights across the electromagnetic spectrum. On the illustration at the bottom, you can see that is just to give the overview that all of this is based on principles which already were published in 1980. And then from 2003 onwards at the University of Leuven, we started developing these domes, these cupolas, to image heritage objects, first in archaeology and later on very specifically towards book heritage. We've been using this system already in many places, first of all, of course, in Belgium, but also all around the world. It has been used in many different kind of projects. And when I state that, or when we state, we already have something like plus 50 publications for which this system has been used, it's probably already a lot more. So if we have a look at the system itself, at the hardware, so the acquisition system. So we have two different systems. One is a dome, which is 80 by 80 centimeters. The other one, the smaller one, we call that one the microdome. And that is the system we're going to talk about most of today, is a system which is 30 by 30 centimeters. So it is quite light, only 13 kilograms it is. It fits in a suitcase. It can be assembled quite easily. We will see that also during a video demo, which is incorporated in this PowerPoint. It only needs minimal calibration. That is a very important element, because engineers, of course, have developed these kind of systems, but it is crucial that people from the humanities can easily manipulate, use these kind of systems. And if you need very complex calibration approaches to be able to work with these kind of systems, then it is becoming difficult to easily use it by people in our fields. Yeah? And so that is also at the bottom, operable by researchers. It needs to be operable by us people from humanities. So we have these two different systems. You see the two different sizes. We have this microdome and this mini dome. And then the other division in the systems we have is whether it is equipped at the inside of the dome with light sources, which are all the same, being white light, again, the kind of light we can see, or whether it is equipped with several kinds of light sources across the electromagnetic spectrum, so the multispectral mini domes or microdomes. So here you can see that in the multispectral portable light dome, the different spectra which have been introduced. Of course, if you want, if it would be important in a project, even other light sources could be mounted inside of the dome, but then a new device needs to be developed. If we speak about white light imaging, or we speak about multispectral imaging, it is very important to stress in the context of this program that actually, once you start working with multispectral imaging, the costs are rising. It becomes much more expensive. You need, for multispectral imaging, you need another kind of camera, which is unfortunately much more expensive. You need another kind of lens, which is a lot more expensive. Your light sources will be a lot more expensive. So once you step into the realm of multispectral imaging, it becomes actually a much more costly environment. And so when you want to use multispectral imaging, and that is a very important issue, you need to make sure that that is something you absolutely need, you absolutely want, because the costs will be much higher. As mentioned before, we are not the only one at the University of Leuven who are using and developing these kind of technologies for heritage imaging. There are many more research groups across the world who have developed similar systems. Yeah? And that is important to stress, because that also means that it's not only at the University of Leuven we have understood the importance. Many other groups around the world are making the same conclusions. So that also means that towards the future, you will see more and more of these technologies used in research projects for all kinds of different heritage. If so many groups around the world are developing their own systems, it means that they all understood the importance. And it also makes clear that it is very interesting to look at these systems right now, as in the future, more and more they will be used. In that context, I very gladly also refer to the talk for tomorrow in this program by Federico Ponchio. He will address actually very similar elements that we will be talking about today. But we will talk about a system which is a fixed setup, so with a dome device, and he tomorrow will more talk about a system where you do not need these kind of dome devices, but where you can perform images with a normal camera, and by a matter of speaking, in your own backyard, you can produce results. So, but this is for tomorrow, but it's already interesting to mention it right now. Again, if we talk about multispectral imaging or imaging in itself, actually we're working with light, and this is something in the in this part on the technology we would like to stress very specifically. We work with light, we work with the reflections of light on your heritage objects, and so the better you manage that light, the better you understand how light reflects on a surface, and so also on a maybe very difficult kind of surface. If your surface is very reflective, if your surface is very dark, so for example, very dark leather, that will all have consequences. So the better you understand how light reflects on a surface, the better results you can produce, and also, for example, the choice can be made: are we going to make the recording with a white light dome, or are we going to make the recording with a multispectral dome? So if we have a look at the electromagnetic spectrum, so that is something you should remember of your physics classes at high school. So light comes in waves, and the shorter the wavelengths, the more you go into the blue color, the violet color, and the ultraviolet color, and the more you go into the longer wavelengths, the more you go towards yellow, red, and eventually infrared. Both ultraviolet and infrared is light we cannot see. But it doesn't mean it doesn't reflect on a surface. It also reflects on a surface. And if you have a camera who can detect those reflections, then a lot of information is to be found over there as well. That is why we use it. Because it's all about reflection, and that I want to stress very specifically in this part of the presentation. But reflection is actually something extremely complicated. If we, for example, have a look at parchment, this is skin. And skin is one of the most complicated things where light is reflecting, because it does not really only reflect on a skin, so on top of the outer level of a skin, but light is also penetrating a little bit into a skin, so also penetrating into the parchment, which means that reflections can be very complex. And then we're introducing even multispectral imaging. So for example, ultraviolet light, the shorter wavelengths, they will almost not penetrate into a surface, where the longer wavelengths, being the red and infrared, they will penetrate deeper into a surface. And so the deeper something in penetrates into a surface, it will also reflect in a much, in a complete different way than when it only reflected on the outside. So this is why I bring up this illustration, to make sure that you understand, if you start using different kind of wavelengths for imaging, the results will not be the same. Yeah? And that is, of course, where the interesting element is to be found. And the more you understand all of that, the better you will be able to interpret the results, and maybe you will be able to figure out things which are interesting for your research. So that's just another illustration to make that clear. With ultraviolet radiation, you will actually have a look and document and visualize and try to understand things which are happening at the very outer limit of your surface. So for example, varnish, it will give information on that. Or if new elements have been added to your surface, then with ultraviolet radiation, that will give you that kind of information. We have the visible light, so these are the things we can see ourselves. And then if you go into infrared radiation, you will actually start seeing things which are happening deeper into a surface. Something which is not part of this system is X-rays, but X-rays will even go deeper, or even will completely transpass the surface you are imaging. On the more technical background, actually the system, so the multi-light reflectance system we use in the portable light dome system, at the backgrounds, the algorithms, the real science which is happening in the software, it uses a system which is called photometric stereo. Yeah? What does that do? Well, we're making a lot of images, all with a light source which is being casted on a surface with a different angle. So at the end of the story, we have a lot of images, all with an illumination which is not exactly the same as on the other picture. Yeah? And based on that kind of data set, so in our case with the microdome, we have 228 different images, all illuminated from another direction, from another angle. And based on that kind of data set, this photometric stereo system approach can understand the surface normals. That means that it can understand in what direction that pixel is oriented, so you have three-dimensional information. And secondly, it can also understand much better than with a normal photographic system what the reflection of that pixel will be in any kind of environment. Yeah. And those, so those two elements, once you have those two kind of informations, you will be able to inspect and study your surface in a complete different kind of way. And you will be able to visualize that kind of data in a complete different kind of way. And that is what we will see once we will start looking at the examples. So again, just a image to illustrate that, that photometric stereo is using the reflection of a surface, and that algorithm, computer algorithm, understands it very well. And the better it understands it, again, the better it can give you good results, which give you abilities to study the surface. Again, some other illustrations to make that clear. We could go on now into detail of these illustrations to understand how exactly all these reflections work, but we will not do that. I just give those slides to make sure that everybody understands it's about reflection. So again, that means if your surface is very reflective, or your surface is very dark, then of course that will have consequences. Yeah? It's just important that everybody understands that, that with this kind of technology, it's all about the reflection. So then if we have a look at some of the results, so here, for example, we have a reconstruction of the relief, that is this blue kind of image. So in this case, for every pixel, the color value which has been attributed actually gives us information on the surface. Yeah? So this is a true image, but for someone who understands these kind of data sets very well, you're actually seeing something in three dimensions right now. Yeah? Of course, for most of you, it's the first time now you see these kind of reconstructions, but actually this shows three-dimensional information. So what everybody has to remember is that in that system, we are inspecting a surface once we go into the viewer environment, and actually below all of that, there is three-dimensional information. And once you have that three-dimensional information, so the image again, that blue kind of image to the left, the other kinds of information we extract with photometric stereo is being put right on top of that. So for example, the color, the texture map or the diffuse map, it is being projected on top of that three-dimensional information. And so when you start interactively, dynamically inspect your surface, it is always based on also understanding the three-dimensionality of your surface. So how does it work then in general? So we have the acquisition system below to the left. Yeah. It creates 228 images in the case of the microdome. So we have 228 different images. Then the computer does the work, that algorithm. Based on all these images, it creates a data set. where all that information is then stored and understood. You can upload it into a viewer environment, and then you can interactively work on that. That is what we will do towards the end of this workshop. We will have a live demo on the Bible of Anjou, and you can then you will be able to see how it exactly works. And even based on those kind of data sets, even extra output can be created, for example, a 3D model of your surface. But when we're working with manuscripts, we have an extra challenge because the bottom of our cupola, our dome, is of course a flat surface, but most manuscripts, they cannot be positioned in that way. Yeah? So we have a challenge over there that it is not possible to put a cupola really on top of a manuscript because a part of the cupola is being blocked by the manuscript itself, and therefore in adapting the system towards the imaging of manuscripts, we had to come up with a solution that a part of the cupola can be removed. In one of the video images we will show in a few minutes, you will be able to see also that we remove a part of that dome system. On the other hand, when we're also working with manuscripts, in a imaging lab, there are already very good devices to image a manuscript. We have conservation book cradles where normal photography is being performed. And so also when we developed our portable light dome system, we made sure that this microdome is also able to position on these kind of book cradles. As such, wherever we go in the world, we only have to take our multispectral or white light dome itself, and actually we can use the equipment which is available at any institution already for imaging manuscripts. So we will now go into a video demo. So here we can see that when we set up a microdome, that we, before we even bring in a manuscript, we will first do a complete checkup of how the system can be manipulated. We made sure that we can move around the dome in all kind of directions. As such, once we are positioning a manuscript below the dome, that we are certain that everything works and that we can make the perfect position of everything. Yeah. In the coming slides, and also all of the examples will be further explained by Professor Bateu. So I give the word back to her.
Thank you, Hendrik. So we are here in the Preciosa, in the Maurits Sabbe Library of the Faculty of Theology. And there we have yes. So last week we took this show. So we are going to image the Bible of Anjou. It's one of the Neapolitan manuscripts you are keeping in Leuven. So Hendrik is now preparing the microdome. And when the installation is fixed, I carefully put the manuscript on the pillows. Yes, and now the piece where the slide is going off the microdome, because when we will lower down the installation, it will softly go in to the corner of the manuscript. So we are opening up to the folio we want to image. So the Bible is from around 30-40, and the illuminator is Cristoforo Oromina, and we will image the presentation of Robert of Anjou. So it's important during the imaging that the folios are staying stable. So The imaging is taking about 3-4 minutes. And now I am fixing the folios with book snakes. So they are very soft ribbons who are heavy enough to keep the folio on the borders, never on the elimination, of course, always on the margins of the folios. They're fixing it. And when everything is stable, Hendrik can come and lower down the microdome into the shape of the open laying manuscript. So what we see is that the angle of the manuscript is not conform to the angle of the microdome, so we had to adapt it slightly. So I'm putting an extra pillow under the board to make it conform. And you see on the right side the image of Robert with the virtues and the vices. So we are fixing it slightly again. And then we can go on and lower down very softly the microdome. So what is very important is the calibration of say the camera, the lens, to the surface of the folio we want to image. This is important because we have a measuring tool, and I will explain you later. We have a measuring tool in the microdome, so we can also make measurements in the X, Y, Z range. So that's the target, that's circles. And after calibration, who is really measuring the distance of the lens towards the folio, I take it off, and of course the protective sheet of silk paper. And when this is finished, we can go to the real imaging of the folio. So we are doing it in a dark environment. It's important, so we are putting out all the lights in the room. It's a very stable room. We don't want vibrations during the taking. And then we starting to do the imaging. It takes 3-4 minutes, depending of well, a darker or a lighter surface. And here you see the sequences of the imaging with the blue light, the green light, the red light, with the different LEDs who were incorporated in the cupola, who were going in a systematic way, taking these 228 images. So now we have on the right side, you see an image from on the top where the lens enters the cupola and is taking the images. You can think it takes a lot of light during well, the 3-4 minutes of recording, but in fact the shots of light are so limited that they are only microseconds. When we calculate the percentage of light the folios and the miniatures are getting during a take, it's only one day through daylight, so it's quite limited and it's not damaging the folio. Yeah, that's the slide when it's finished. So we are just moving manually the dome. It's always a check that, of course, the installation never would touch the illumination. So it's really floating above the manuscript or the drawing you want to examine. So you always have to be with two to just doing the manipulation and the checking. So this was last week in the library of the Faculty of Theology. We were working on this. And just to show you how easy it is to make and to do the imaging. So afterwards, there's the processing of the file we took. And after the processing, that's taking 10, 15 minutes or even shorter, we can go to the viewer of and look to the images and the results of the imaging. And then the work for the researcher is starting. What do you want to see? What will you want to discover? What do you want to use of the information of the computerized image we have taken? So what we're going to do now is look to some examples. These are screenshots. It means it's not the dynamic image. We will show you that at the end. But the presentation now in the PowerPoints are screenshots from images we took from different manuscripts or other objects we will present. So first some images from the white light, then we will continue with the multispectral lights results. So white light microdome, it's very good for topography. It means we are going to look to elements on the surface, and you think it's flat paper, it's flat parchment, it's flat leather, is flat, but it's not at all. So the lights, the triangles you see, the yellow triangles, they are in fact what the lights you're activating with your cursor to see the characteristics on the relief or the topography. So you manipulate it as a researcher, the light sources to reveal certain information. So here you see an image without colors. We start with color, then you're going to the shaded phase, and you really can see that this seal, this print into the topography of the leather is revealing, and it's the printer's mark of Plantin, who is a very famous Antwerp printer of the 16th century. And we can go, and what you really can see very slightly is that he's using a compass to position the stamp really in the middle of the binding. This is the sketch filter, so we can make a kind of computerized rubbings of the marks, of the printer's marks into the leather. And so this is the drawing we can reveal. We call it digital rubbings because it's much more accurate than the rubbings that archaeologists or book historians or book archaeologists were taking in the past decennia. So also for blind stamped book covers, book bindings, it's very useful. And this is a very elaborate 16th century book binding, a German book binding, where you have representations of figures from antiquity, from the classics, like Virgilius and Ovidius, and the reformers, Luther and Hus, Calvin and Erasmus. So we are looking with the microdome to it. And so you really can see, if you're using here and you're seeing the green and the red, cursors we are manipulating. So you are coming in the completely shaded. So we are using the lights in the cupola who are very, very low. And then you'll be coming to see a very, very good profile. Here you, without a color. This is a sketch modus. And here you see on the left side how you see it with the human eye. Then with shaded lights, then without color, so you see grayscale images becomes and it makes clearer, and on the right side you see the sketch modus. For manuscripts, and this is a folia from an antiphonary who is, well, like often it's reused as a book cover in the 19th century, but you are going to look to the rubrics, so the lettering in red. And on the image right, you see really the thickness of the lead reds, the color that is used to make the rubrics. And you really see the thickness, how the scribe has put his quill onto the parchment. And in the beginning, you have more paint in the quill, and so the paint layer will be thicker. We have the measuring tool. That's what we did during the taking, putting these calibrations, these circles. So with the software, we can measure the height of the letterings, but we can also measure the profile. So here you see the text in the iron gall ink, and you see parts are faded and parts are still very, very thick. And then we can measure how thick the ink is into the quill. So we can also make an extrapolation how many letters the scribe could write with one time dipping his quill into the ink pot. So these are the thickness of the different shades. Here you see one of the folios of at the end of the Bible of Anjou, and you see how with the cursor you can make the different shading. You see the topography, the curling, the soft curling of the parchment without light color, where you really see the thickness of the gold foil on the gesso. The measurements, and we can really measure the thickness of the paint layers and the gold foil. So it's something you cannot do with a normal ruler. And because it's a computerized image, you see here the lead white on the blue is thicker. It's a very thick paint layer, and you see the topography imaged in that. So surface characteristics, this is an antiphonary from the 14th century. It's Flemish, and it was very badly restored during the French Revolution. So you see at the bottom of the page, you see a very thick old repair here, an old repair. This is a shading where you really can see how the traction of the old repair on the original 14th century antiphonary. We can make measurements how thick it is. We can also 3D models with the mesh lab. Here you see the topography of the large folio. These are measurements we took before the conservation treatments, because it was necessary to remove the old repairs to stabilize and to not further damage the folio. Another example is a Bible from Tongeren, where you see a very nice large initial L. And what was interesting for us, that's the sketch modus we're in. We really can see very clearly the blind ruling. So it's with the stylus down, and this is the ruling, and you see it's going through the initial. And we even can measure the thickness and the distance between the ruling lines. So for paleography, codicology, it's a very, very useful instrument. So that's how we measure the distance between the two blind ruled lines. Another way we use the microdome software in the technique is to measure the changes that are acute before and after conservation. So you see again the antiphonary with a very, very nice illumination of the Ark of Noah. Before the treatment, the folio, the parchment folio, was very cockled and curled, and so we did some soft relaxing in a Gore-Tex chamber. It means it's with damp. This is in the middle an image with a very strong shaded light, and then after before and after, we can make the measurements. So the blue line you see here, it's before treatment. This is the line after treatment. So Hendrik, you can go further with the multispectral imaging.
Yes, thank you, Lieve. So now a number of examples with the multispectral PLD system. So important to say is that actually the workflow is the same. So whether we image with the white light dome or with the multispectral dome, it's actually the same. Also, the software is the same. It is all integrated in one and the same system. So that is very important. It doesn't really matter in the viewing system whether we upload a result of the white light dome or a result of the multispectral dome. It is actually the same research environment. So one of the first things we can do is we can inspect the results in the different spectra itself. We can have a look at the infrared results. So that is in black and white. So maybe that is something for many people, not that easy to understand. We're using blue light, we're using red light, but actually the results is a black and white response. So then we can see whether a specific color, so for example, the red rose, how did it react? In infrared, you can see it is completely white. So that clearly shows that this type of red pigment is reflecting very heavily in infrared. Not all red pigments will reflect very high in infrared. So that is a start for us to identify or to understand what kind of pigment which has been used. So this is just an example. And then we can also start combining the results. So the black and white results we see over here, if we combine them again as a RGB, red, green, blue image, but we use the infrared or we use the ultraviolet results, then we will actually start having colored results again. But they are not real colors, they are false colors. Yeah? So these are false colors results, but again, we can use it to differentiate the different pigments which have been used on a surface or the different materials, and then you can differentiate them in a different manner, and then hopefully for the specific research you do, it is significant for you. We've been using it for a whole couple of projects, this multispectral approach, and we will only show a few examples because we could go on for many PowerPoints on the results of the multispectral microdome. But this is one of the very interesting results we had, and as it is on the example of the Bible of Anjou, so it is exactly the same image we took last week again for the demonstration, and also in the live demo in a couple of minutes it will be exactly on this depiction. But here we can see that in the blue field, when we use the multispectral results, that we could actually start to understand that this blue field we have over there actually consists of two different pigments, which is quite normal, but we could document it and we could even understand which parts of the blue field where ultramarine was used or in which parts that azurite was used. Yeah? So we're using an imaging system here, but as you have imaged it with the multispectral dome, we can even start understanding the distribution of certain pigments. Yeah? Very important, it works for a number of pigments, for a number of materials, but not for all. Yeah, but this is an example where we could use this kind of data set for these specific pigments. So this is a good example where we have been able to use the results to understand what our surface is about that we study. Something completely different. It's not an example on a manuscript in this case, but it was a project where we used the multispectral dome for Egyptian statues, and we had a lot of very faded ink traces. reds or carbon containing pigments. And actually on the original objects, almost none of that was still visible. But when we used the multispectral results, several of the text lines could be identified again. So that is another purpose, another good example of using this kind of research equipment is when you have faded traces with multispectral imaging, and certainly in combination with the microdome, you can make sure that faded traces become much more visible again. And then something completely else again. This is the last example. We have here an example of a coin which we have imaged, but you would have exactly the same, for example, on a manuscript book cover in leather. You would see exactly the same phenomenon. So if we image it with infrared light and we have a look at how the surface has been interpreted by the system. Again, remember what we said at the beginning of the talk. Infrared will penetrate a surface a little bit more deeper. So it will actually, if we reconstruct the surface, the topography, the relief, the geometry of your object, it will actually reconstruct a relief that we cannot feel ourselves. Yeah, as humans, but that the light can understand. So if we have the relief of a coin with infrared light, it will be completely different with infrared light or with ultraviolet light. It all depends how deep all of that has penetrated into the surface. And again, that can be very interesting to use in specific research projects. So these are a couple of examples in multispectral imaging. At the very end of the talk, we will present also a number of publications, and in those publications, more examples can be found. So this is the end of the examples we have prepared. We have also been working in the couple of two last years on a project with a new Pixel Plus viewer. It's an online viewer, which makes it possible that all the results we produce, but for example, also the results, for example, that you will see tomorrow produced, or many of the results produced in the talk by Federico Ponchio, that those kind of results, they can actually be uploaded in this online viewer. And so everyone who is interested in interacting with these results themselves, they can upload it in that viewer. A month ago, we presented that viewer for the first time in an international conference, which was also online, obviously. And the good thing about online conferences is that they are being recorded, as this one is recorded, and that you can reuse them in other recorded conferences. Yeah. So in this case, we will have a look at this presentation. It's 18 minutes, that presentation. It has been voiced by one of our project collaborators, Vincent van Weddingen, and we can have a look at it right now. I hope this will work.
Hi, I'm Vincent. I work at the Art and History Museum in Brussels and the Department of Electrical Engineering at KU Leuven, and I'll be presenting Pixel Plus, integrating and standardizing of various interactive single camera multi-light imagery. This is a joint work with Hendrik, Bruno, Chris, Lieve, Frederik, Athena, Paul, Luc and Mark. The Pixel Plus project is funded by Belspol's Brain Pioneering Program. The partners are the Art and History Museum in Brussels, the KU Leuven, and more specifically the Department of Electrical Engineering and the Faculty of Arts, KU Leuven's Libraries Department Digitization, and the KBR, Belgium's National Scientific Library. To begin, a brief overview of the single camera multi-light technology, abbreviated throughout the presentation as SCML. Next, the main body of this presentation is the integration of two types of SCML, namely PLD and RTI. To facilitate this integration and to open up other possibilities, we propose a novel SCML web-optimized file format. In the next topic, we'll be addressing some more details about the Pixel Plus viewer and the dissemination site. Finally, some conclusions and pointers to future work. Single camera multi-light technology has been researched a lot, mostly because its combination of relatively easy acquisition hardware, in essence only one camera and one light source, and yet powerful analysis and visualization of surfaces. Research and application papers are scattered across several fields and sometimes use different terminology, such as single camera multi-light, multi-light image collections, relightable images, multi-light reflectance, reflectance transformation imaging, 2D plus imaging. We've chosen to address this technology as single camera multi-light, which refers to the acquisition specifics to obtain this type of data. Here are a few examples of SCML acquisition devices and strategies. On the left, you can see a multispectral microdome, origin of K11, that is used to examine the surface of an ancient Egyptian coffin in the Art and History Museum in Brussels. It consists of a hemispherical shell onto which several LEDs are placed and a camera placed at the top. On the right, a so-called RTI dome, Southampton origin, which has a similar setup. These two devices are examples of acquisition systems which take entire image sequences via an automated process. For each image, another light source at a different position on the dome is switched on. A dome setup isn't necessarily required for SCML acquisitions. On the left, you can see Marlon Lum, Mark Mutch, and Carla Schroer from Cultural Heritage Imaging performing an RTI recording using the highlight RTI method. A camera, flash, remote control, rope, and a reflective sphere is all the hardware required for this acquisition type. It especially allows the creation of single-view datasets of larger surfaces. On the right, an early example of an SCML dome designed at the Visual Computing Lab in Pisa in the mid-2000s. Highlight RTI is cheaper and more flexible compared to a dome setup. A dome setup is typically faster and can provide more accurate repeatable measurements. So, the input for single-camera multi-light algorithms is a set of images of an object that is being illuminated from various angles. Here you can see the original input images from a recording of a cuneiform tablet with an SCML dome equipped with white light LEDs. Now, because the appearance and surface properties of materials can depend on the spectral distribution of incident and reflected light, also multispectral SCML acquisition hardware has been developed. They follow the same processing pipelines as datasets created with white light. So let's start with RTI. Given a set of images, RTI finds a mathematical description of the observed pixel intensity as a function of the incident light direction. This results in an interactive image, which can be virtually illuminated from a certain angle. In this work, we have focused on polynomial texture maps developed at HP Labs by Tom Malzbinder and others, hemispherical harmonics, and Gaussian radial basis functions, which is more recently developed technique by ISTI, an Institute of the National Research Council of Italy, CNR. Other RTI data fitting and interpolation approaches exist, but are less common. RTI's goal is photorealistic relighting, though methods to recover surface gradients have been developed for PTM, HSH, and RBF RTI. The portable light dome at K11 follows a different approach, in the sense that it tries to find surface properties such as surface gradients, appearance models in the form of reflectance maps, BRDF parameters, a depth map, surface albedo, all following a physical model. It is based on traditional photometric stereo and as such follows Lambert's cosine law for diffuse materials, which states that the observed radiance, which can be proven to be view independent, is a product of the incoming radiance, the albedo, and the dot product of the surface normal and light direction. It is extended to cope with noisy data, non-Lambertian behavior, and to extract more surface features. This figure gives a graphical overview of the previous slide. We're looking with camera C to the scene. When a light source at direction L is switched on, the material reflects light according to its BRDF rho. A Lambertian material reflects light in all directions equally. Most materials exhibit non-ideal Lambertian behavior. This material, for example, has a specular lobe, meaning that in that direction, the material reflects more light. PLD has been extended to cope with this type of non-ideal behavior. If the light source would be coming from a grazing angle on the right of the figure, the surface on that spot would be in its own shadow. This is another scenario which has to be dealt with in order to calculate the normal and albedo. To make the previous slides a bit more clear, this slide shows an example of an RBF RTI file. The input images of a seal of Charles V were recorded with K.O. Leuven's Minidome and processed using the Relight library of ISTI as an RBF RTI. What you can see here is a virtual relighting in the PixelPlus web viewer, which will be discussed further in this presentation. As stated previously, RTI can be seen as a data fitting approach, interpolating between light directions. One can see that the resulting relighting looks photorealistic. Effects like self-shadowing, specularities, and interreflections are not modeled explicitly, but are entangled in the RTI interpolation functions and are as such intrinsically included. This slide provides an example of a PLD processed file. The recovered surface gradients and albedo are visualized first as regular Lambertian shading, which you can see here. The pixel intensity depends on the product of the albedo and the cosine of the angle between the surface normal and the light direction. So there is no self-shadowing, there is no interreflectance. Because surface gradients can reveal a lot of information, PLD has several visual styles to visualize the local surface orientation. In the shaded style, which you can see now, the local surface color is removed, allowing to more carefully study the surface gradients. In the final visual style, which will show up in a moment, is the sketch mode, and it accentuates the rapid change of surface orientations. It mimics pencil drawings. Texels where the surface gradient abruptly changes are colored black. These are good examples of how extracting information from datasets and understanding the surface characteristics can substantiate the study of heritage artifacts. This final visual style is a false color normal map. So, after this introduction of both similar yet distinctive techniques and already existing derivatives, we can start with the part on integration of PLD and RTI. The first type of integration of RTI and PLD involves working with existing RTI and PLD processed files. This approach is important as a lot of databases already exist with these processed RTI or PLD files. In the PixelPlus viewer, therefore, both file types can be viewed with their own visual styles. For PTM, HSH RTI, and RBF RTI, an ambient map and normal map can be calculated from the data in these files by the browser. When already processed PTM, HSH RTI, and RBF RTI files are uploaded in the PixelPlus viewer, these calculations are made in the background. When finished, also PLD's visual styles become available for the user. With this first type of integration, we aim to provide an easy-to-implement strategy in which existing processed datasets can benefit from the advantages both axes of the SCML technologies have been developed. This slide provides an example of the first type of integration of RTI and PLD. This HSH RTI file can be parsed and viewed with the default RTI relighting style, which you can see now. In a separate WebWorker thread, the auxiliary maps, namely the normal map, which you can see now, and the ambient map, are being calculated, after which PLD's viewing styles become available. So this is the RTI specular enhancement style, which has some parameters, which I'll explain in a moment. So this is an RTI file viewed with an RTI visual style. Now, next, it is viewed with a style developed for PLD files. And this is another style developed for PLD files. All right, the second type of integration developed in the PixelPlus project of the RTI and PLD technologies deals with the original SCML image datasets. The output of processing with PTM, HSH, RTI, RBF, RTI, and PLD, in essence all 2D image data, can be grouped together into a single file. Opening this file with the PixelPlus viewer enables all visual styles. As the needed data for all these visual styles is processed using the original input image set and the original processing algorithms, the quality will be much higher, or will be higher than the first integration type. The second type of integration allows a very clean manner to compare the output of various SCML techniques within one and the same viewing environment. Nonetheless, a detailed analysis of each technique's performance is outside the scope of this paper. But a general remark can be made that for photorealistic relighting, those using the RBF-RTI technique performs best. A self-shadowing non-Lambertian behavior and interreflectance are not modeled in the default PLD shader, these results can look less lifelike. The quality of the recovered surface gradients tends to be better using PLD compared to RTI, as PLD is more robust against noisy data. An in-depth study of these outcomes should therefore be performed soon in the near future, but needs to take into account various metrics to compare the quality, various fitting algorithms, and really has to be careful before drawing conclusions. The input set of images has been processed with all supported SCML techniques. PLD's visual styles are available, as you can see. So are the default RTI visual styles. They're also implemented. As all techniques can calculate the surface gradients, which you can see here. Also, the source of these gradients are separately stored and can be activated in the PixelPlus viewer. So you can see that we're browsing here through the normal maps. Here we're visualizing the normal maps with PLD's shaded style, which is another way to visualize the surface gradient. And you can see small changes if we're changing the normal source here. The specular enhancement style of RTI introduces a specular Phong-like term in the rendering equation to accentuate the surface gradients a bit. As this visual style also uses the calculated normals, a small difference can be seen when changing the normal source, which you will see in a moment. Now the normal source is changed. You can see small changes there. A final aspect in that regard concerns the question whether SCML can also capture through 3D. SCML can capture properties like surface gradients, albedo, and material appearance models. These properties are quite often overlooked 3D properties. When trying to create photorealistic renders, these properties tend to be more important than the quality of the general shape. Compared to other 3D scanning techniques, SCML is particularly good at capturing fine surface details. By integrating the surface gradients, a depth image can be reconstructed. This 3D shape can be viewed in the PixelPlus viewer with the various visual styles superimposed on it. In this example, the shaded style was chosen to highlight the shape. Now, to facilitate a second type of integration and to optimize web consultation of SCML datasets in general, in a responsible future-oriented manner, we propose a novel file format. Legacy RTI and PLD formats, PTM, RTI, Kern, ZUN, are not optimized for the web, nor flexible enough to support integration of other SCML technology and be IIIF compliant. The By the PixelPlus project proposed web-optimized format is based on GLTF and minimizes loading and processing time in the browser. It supports various SCML formats and can support high-resolution imagery. High-definition recordings, such as more than 30 megapixel, are becoming more and more common. So there is a need to consult these and even much more bigger files in full resolution. Finally, the novel format makes it more easy to add metadata and various annotation types. SCML is a very flexible set of tools. A scholar should be able to assess the quality of an SCML file. In the metadata, users should state how an SCML file came to fruition, e.g. which hardware was used, which methodology was followed, which processing pipeline was used. A new format should facilitate the integration of this type of metadata. The Pixel Plus viewer is hosted on this website and is currently public as a beta version. The framework is written in HTML, JavaScript and WebGL. The site runs on a regular web server, so collection holders with these types of SCML datasets of their heritage artifacts can choose to host their own version if needed. Both local files as well as files hosted on another web server, e.g. a web consultable database of a heritage institute, are supported. Viewer configuration, such as rotation, initial light position, initial visual style, can be passed through URL parameters or saved directly into the SCML web file. Next to the Pixel Plus web viewer, we also introduce a dissemination site, which is targeted at both an enthusiastic visitor wanting to learn more about SCML and a heritage scholar looking for specifics on a particular viewing style. By providing information and background information, we hope to address both types of visitors' needs. To conclude, we've provided a framework to bring PLD and RTI closer together. The Pixel Plus viewer allows cross-SCML type database examinations. The creation and adoption of a novel SCML web format is an ongoing community effort. Together with the dissemination site, which provides valuable background info on SCML technologies, we hope to further popularize this set of technologies. Thank you for watching this presentation.
So the Pixel Plus viewer, so the challenges we have with this kind of technology is that we have around the world, we have a number of players, a number of institutions which have developed this type of interactive, we call it 2D plus interactive data sets. Yeah. And the most well known of that, you can see it also on the screen right now, is called RTI, Reflectance Transformation Imaging. And then we have the system in Leuven, which is called Portable Light Dome. And it has several file formats. You can also see that right now. It has Kun files, Zun files, PTM, RTI. So you have different kind of data sets, but actually they all have the same kind of input data. What we saw throughout our presentation, you have several pictures and they are all being illuminated in a different way of one and the same surface. So it's all the same. So you have the kind of data sets, but different systems which have been developed around the world, they process these results in a different way. And with this Pixel Plus project, we try to make sure that those different systems which are around the world, that they will grow closer to each other. So that means that we created a viewer, which is also immediately online. As such, everybody can also use it. So it's already online right now. Everybody can consult and use it. But in that new viewer, both results coming from the RTI platforms, but also the results coming from the PLD platform, they can be consulted in one and the same research environment. Yeah? And so that is the big exercise that this Pixel Plus project has done, and it can be used by everyone. It's not such a simple endeavor, because the way how we are visualizing the data, and certainly in an online environment, it was not exactly the same how RTI and PTM platforms did it. So that's why you need an engineer, software engineer, to perform that kind of exercise. Otherwise, it is impossible to put it on a online platform. Solution we found is actually to create a new file, type of file. So like most of us, we know what Photoshop is, Adobe Photoshop. And there you can, in Photoshop, you can upload a JPEG or you can upload a TIFF file. But then to make sure that it works perfectly on Photoshop itself, it will create a PSD file. That is a Photoshop file itself. And so we did the same. We created a new kind of file type. It is called GLTF. And as such, we hope in the future, so we have just launched that Pixel Plus viewer, and we hope in the future that whether it are our results coming from our dome, but also results coming from other domes, or results coming from the hand-on approach that Federico Ponchio will demonstrate tomorrow, that it will actually all be able, or we will all be able to put it in a GLTF file format, and all of that can be uploaded in this online viewer. So this is actually the exercise behind that Pixel Plus viewer. So it's open source, it can be used by anyone, everyone, everybody who has a this type of data sets, which we have been talking about today, can use it on that platform. Okay.
Yes, thank you, Hendrik, for giving us a resume. So this page, it's online, so it's accessible for everybody. You have different points here, but here you see, go directly to the viewer, and that's what we will do now. And what you see here, these are examples that are on the web page, just to make the users comfortable with the types of images and materials you can do. So you see the cuneiform tablets, you see the Bible of Anjou, you see a seal of the archives, it's a wax seal, you see Japanese prints, you see drawings of Bruegel, you see the coins, you see manuscripts. So these are demos, and you can try them after this session if you're curious how it works. You can go on it and look to, that's the images, that's the file that we retrieved, that we made from the object. If you have these files, you can use the viewer to examine them, and that's the easy thing. If you have the file and the viewer, if you are in the States or in Italy or in Moscow, you can use it. So what we will do now is look to one of the image we took last week. So it's open local file. So I'm going to my file here of the Bible of Anjou. And then you see downloading the file into the browser memory.
So what is actually happening right now is that this file is being uploaded into the system and is also adapted to the online platform to make sure that in the online environment, this kind of data can be visualized. So it takes a time. When you are in Belgium, it will go probably the fastest because this program is on a server at our university. When you are in Italy, it will go slower. When you are on the other side of the ocean, it will probably even go a bit more slower. So, because all of that information has to be uploaded in that viewer environment. These are pretty large files. It's 200-300 megabytes easily, which have all the information. So it's uploaded right now. Lieve?
Yes, so The folio, it's a quite large folio, but the imaging with the microdome, we can do approximately 13 to 18 centimeters. So now the image of Robert of Anjou is horizontally, so we will flip it, and then you can see it in the right direction. We can zoom out, we can zoom in. And so what you see here, these are the cursors. That's the, we can manipulate them with your mouse or your touch screen. And with that, you manipulate and you're going over the surface. If I am doing it to the center, it means it's are the most zenithal lights of the microdome you are using. And if you're going down, we are going to the more distant lights, so it becomes darker. So you have here, we can zoom in, we can go into the image, and we can move the image. So now what you see, it's about 5 to 8 centimeters. We can go even more in detail. And you see here, Robert Avanjou, he has a hole. And it's because these folio were very close to the cover, who was in wood. So during time, woodworms were in the wooden cover, and they are eating through the board, but also eating through the first folios where this beautiful diptych is kept. So you have several holes here in about 1 millimeter large, who are perforating the illumination. So we can examine, and then what's important, we go down, and then you have here filter parameters, and you have intensity of the light. And so with this, we can move up and down. And these are changing the intensity of the light. So that's something you, as a researcher, you can manipulate. All the buttons here you can manipulate, and you can search for the information you want to know. So, well, we have Robert Avanjou on the throne. He has his scepter, he has his orb, and he's looking at the right side. And here you see devices, the female devices. He's under a canopy, he's sitting under a canopy. You see his coat of arms. You see the beautiful imitation of the textiles on the canopy. And we want to know more about how is it painted. We know the illuminator is Cristoforo Oromina, who had a quite large illuminating workshop working for Robert of Anjou. We know there are other Bibles he illuminated. There are a few surviving. And he is, well, sitting here, he's crowned. He has his doctor's cap. We can do different things. So this is the normal, sharpen the image. We can go with the cursors up and down. And then we can make it shaded. And this is what we do when we are illuminating the colors. And here you see, in fact, the surface of the paint layers. And paint layers, it's very important to know, they have different kind of thicknesses. They are, have different pigments, so it can be azurite, malachite, they can be iron components, copper components, maybe tin components. And we know that through other types of research, for more analytical research, this is an imaging technique. And we are looking now, first at all, what you see here, these undulations, this is the surface of the parchment. So it's not in the paint layer, it's in the parchment, who has different kinds of shades. We can go deeper, and then you see that in fact the little points here in lead white, it's a very thick paint layer, they are going, they are showing more sharply. Maybe going down to the image very softly. You're seeing also here that the skin colors of the face of Robert, they are much thinner than, for example, here the azurite and the lapis lazuli, who are here, or thicker. And this is mosaic gold. So we're going back to the color. This giving a little bit more light. So this lilies, the fleur de lis, the symbol of, well, the French heraldic symbol, they are not painted in gold. This is gold, the crown of Robert. It's flat gold, so it's not on a gesso on a carrying layer. This is done in mosaic gold, so it's another component. And what you see here, this is damage. It means there's flaking. There's material lost through the, well, it's 7 centuries old, the manuscript. So we're going down. And for example, here you see the hand of Robert. And I'm going back to shade it. And I have to, no, it's too much light. I have to take off the light a little bit. So I'm going further with my cursor. I can also go in. So it's really like playing with light intensity, with positions of your cursor. You can do it. Then, for example, you can see very well here how this orb was in gold has a difference, and I go in a little bit closer, who has a kind of a crackly, it's a kind of pattern of cracking, who is completely different than the crackly on the paint layers. So I'm zooming out now. What you see here is really the undulations in the paint layers. Going back to color position. So what we know, this is vermilion, but these are earth colors. So the canopy, it's red ochre, who is a very thin paint layer. And so you really can see it also in this shaded environment that the paint is much thinner. For the moment, the measuring tool is not implemented yet in the viewer, but this will come in one of the coming months. And then you also can do the measuring with the viewer. So now we can explore the different visualization with the multispectral. And that's what we see with the infrared and the red and the green, red and the green light. It's the differentiation of the pigment layers. And that's something that we are doing in combination with analytical research. So we have information about the pigment composition. And as you know, azurite, we can detect with, for example, macro XRF, but ultramarine or lapis lazuli, we cannot detect with macro XRF. You only can do it with Raman. So through the imaging, who is, well, much quicker than an analytical research, we could see, and that was quite interesting, that we see that the blue surface of the canopy where the fleur-de-lis were painted on was as two colors, with the infrared green-blue light, that the bottom, the underlaying was done in azurite. And what you see here in the lacunas, you see you're going through the surface of the azurite, but at the second layer, they used the much more expensive lapis lazuli. And that's what we often see in painting techniques as well in panel paintings as in illumination. They are using different compositions of blue to create as well very, very bright, very precious materials. What's also interesting when we go in here to the beautiful rope, protocol air rope of Robert of Anjou, you're seeing these dots who are in fact, it's a glacis, it means it's an neck, egg yolk, who is mixed with some vermilion, and you really see the difference of how the aging of the egg yolk is giving these brilliant touches on the surface. So these are the touches of lead white on the skin face. And it's like you explore with the different filters information that can be revealed. So you're using your set here, your buttons, to look to the details, and you're using your zoom function, using your cursors to combine the information. So now I'm working with my cursor the whole time. And so, Hendrik, you want to add something to this?
No, I think it's that was very clear. The only thing I would still mention is when you go a little bit lower, yeah? Mm-hmm. So over there you have the normals. If you see over there the normal source, go up a bit, go up a bit, go up a bit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, stop, yeah. Yeah, I have to go down again, but it doesn't really matter. In the viewer, you can also change the normal sources. So this is what I showed with that coin in the presentation. So if you go closer now to the surface, then you will easier see the result of that. So now infrared is being used. So now actually the normal sources, that means the relief, so the topography, which is being used. So below the texture, the color you see, we have now the results with the infrared. If you go closer even or to the craquelé or to something like that, where that is very expressive. Okay. Yeah, and now when you go across from infrared to ultraviolet, you will see actually that the surface will change. You see that the surface is changing a little bit. And there's, for example, on a study we did on varnish, we could see that when the surface was reconstructed with infrared light, or it was reconstructed with blue or ultraviolet light, that you were actually seeing a different kind of surface with the multispectral results. Yeah? So then again, in that case, the research question was something else, but also the surface reconstruction all depends on which light source you have been using.
Yeah, so UV is having more information on the on the surface, like on the varnish. With IR, infrared, you go deeper into the pictorial layers and you can, for example, see underdrawings. We know that Cristoforo Oromina didn't use underdrawings, what's quite interesting because he was such a skilled illuminator. So we don't see underdrawings, but quite often illuminators and panel paintings, they would use the first layout of the image would be in carbon. In a carbon medium like charcoal, or and then you would see it with infrared. So it's like what is usually done in paintings and the normal technologies like infrared reflectographies, what they use in paintings, this is a kind of adaptation of the system using lights, and we can go much more in detail. So there's another interesting tool. Well, you can set it, you have here a fill scheme, you can rotate, but then take a one-to-one printout. And in fact, you're taking an image, a screenshot of that, and you can do it, well, as much as you want. And then this screenshot, it goes in your saved data, and you can use it in a PowerPoint or in your presentation. So it's, well, also as, say, a tool you use for documenting your research, it's quite interesting, and that's how we usually document what we when we are looking to it and using the microdome that we are using it in this way. So we can go out, and so in fact you can do it you can do it with the demos or in the Pixel Plus viewer. But once you have the data, like the data we had last year in the Jura Mini, you can open it now since a few weeks with the new online viewer, and you go back your stack of images that are taken with the microdome. And if I remember well, in one day, we can do about 20 images because, well, of course, you have to manipulate the manuscripts, you have to prepare it, you have, well, it's you have to be very carefully, of course. But in one day, we're taking what we want to document, then we are processing it, and then it's open for everybody who, well, who's interested in the material, who can be, it can be papyrus, it can be eliminated manuscripts, it can be texts more difficult to read. So there are a lot of possibilities. And well, the interesting thing is with the new software and the new viewer, that is different types of files who are well brought together with this different kind of tools of imaging can be now online viewed. So perhaps we can go to the last slides of the PowerPoint, Hendrik.
Yes, so if you de-share your screen.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So we have the, we just had a live demo in the Pixel Plus viewer. So it was mentioned already a couple of times, but we actually have two viewing systems. We just had a look at the Pixel Plus viewer. And as Lieve has mentioned, for example, not all functions are already incorporated in the online browser viewer, for example, that measure tool, but also some of the more analytic approaches to understand exactly how certain pigments have reflected across the spectral bands, then you actually still need the desktop standalone version. But that one is also free for download via portablelightdome.wordpress.com. Over there, when you go to software, you could also download that. Mostly always the latest version we have. Sometimes it's a beta version, sometimes it's an already fully controlled version which can be downloaded over there. So we actually have two viewer systems, one which is for peer viewing and one which is for in-depth research. Yeah. So we just had that live demo. And then at the very end of the PowerPoint, we gave a small selection of a number of the publications we have, specifically dealing on some of the examples we have incorporated in this PowerPoint. Yeah. So they are over there. And I mostly on our ResearchGate or Academia web pages, those can be consulted, or other publications on the topic can be found. And also very interesting to mention here is, as Lieve has already said, we have used this technology also quite often in combination with other technologies like XRF mapping or microscopic analysis of the manuscript. So then if you consult these kind of publications where it is combined with other methods, you can also more truly understand where the value, where the use, where the true use of this kind of technology becomes really interesting or is of lesser interest, and that other technologies need to be used, or the combination makes the difference in all of that. And I think then that's about it. Thank you very much. And I guess now we have time for questions.
So thank you, Lieve. Thank you, Hendrik, for this beautiful presentation and this really interesting and enriching overview on this project. I think that all the that you showed all the potentialities, the possibilities that this kind of technologies and instrumentation that you used can do with the manuscripts and with the also with the ancient book, and the potentialities that are already could be also infinite because of the combination you can do or with the material, with the writing surface, with the pigments, with the illumination, with so all the codicological and paleographical and even textual and philological aspects could be involved in this research. So I think it's really, really important. It's really pertinent with what we do. And I'm really glad to also to see that the online viewer is ready to is working, and so it's also really important because we can also manage by ourselves if we have some file processed file to upload to your system. The first question I just want to make the first break the glass, the ice, and do the first question. I just want to know if it's possible maybe one time to incorporate the online viewer in some other projects, online projects, like for example the Illuminated Dante project. We already processed some Dante illumination, and we just wanted to know if it's possible to incorporate the viewer in our website.
So it depends, of course, what you see as incorporating. Yeah? Well, there are many ways to incorporate.
Yeah, I mean,
if you were like this, but so what is possible right now already is if you have files, mm-hmm. So you have data sets, you have results, yeah, you have them in your own system, yeah, that when you click on that file, that it's opens that data set immediately in the viewer. So if you are in a browsing environment where you have your files, your data sets, that they immediately are being linked to the viewer itself. A true incorporation where you have the viewer and you have it in your own data set, in your own online database or your own online research environment, at this moment that is not possible.
Yeah. Okay.
But
okay.
So one type of integration is possible. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
But I think you could, well, the files we took last year from the Dante manuscript in Gigino Lamini, you could already use on your Dante platform.
Yes, of course. Of course. Another option is for example to upload our data in the online viewer, take some screenshots, results, for example, and after upload in our system, if we want to just show something particular, some particular result, mm-hmm. which we consider useful for our research,
as you can also see, and in the website of the Pixel Plus viewer. Sometimes we make also animated GIFs because that's any platform, yeah? And nice. it because you more and more we are working with smart devices, with our phones, with our tablets, and so on. And of course, these kind of technologies, although they do work also on smart devices, but then not necessarily as fluent on an Android phone than on an iPhone, and so on and so forth. So there's so many platforms these days, and we need to take that in consideration. And so therefore, actually, if you make a few screenshots and you put them in an animated GIF, that works on any platform. Okay. And that, of course, that is something you want. If you have good results, that at least you know that from whatever platform it is being consulted, at least they will all see the same results. Also in online publications, for example, it can be interesting. You can always provide the data sets, and then people who have possibilities to consult the complete data sets, that is great. But actually a simple animated GIF might already do the job as well. No?
Yeah, you're right. So I don't know if there are some questions. Don't hesitate. I'm talking to to the audience. I'm talking especially to the students, but also to the other participants from some intervenants. I see Fabio Cusimano maybe wants to ask something. Prego, Fabio. Fabio Cusimano is the head of the digitization project in the Veneranda Biblioteca Ambrosiana of Milan. Prego, Fabio. Fabio Cusimano asked if did you use this device with palimpsest, and what the results? What kind of results can be done with this kind of support?
Perhaps Hendrik can go in a more technical side, but as we told you, we have different kind of equipment and tools to research manuscripts, and we have a project, it's called 3P, and it's advanced imaging of papyrus paper and parchment. And in this project, we got a new multispectral imaging system who is more performant than the multispectral microdome. So that's the interesting thing. If you have a lab who has a setup with different kind of tools, we also had a new infrared camera for the Apollo camera. So we're using different approaches to do the imaging. So one of the things is from the microdome, it's very movable, so we can travel with it. And other equipments are less movable. And I must say we have some results with on palimpsest, and it's really depending how the palimpsest is created. It can be done with scraping, it can be done with juices, so with a kind of semi-chemical processes. And sometimes we get results, and we can see some the faded ink, the traces of the faded ink. But the new multispectral unit is more performant. So perhaps Hendrik, you can tell something more in detail.
Yeah. So I agree. Yeah. In the first place, what Lieve is bringing forward. So if it is about palimpsest, the benefit is in the first place found. That is what we know based on photography, on multispectral photography, is by having quite a lot of different spectral bands. Yeah, in this case, with the multispectral portable lightome, we only have 5 different spectral bands. So if you really want to search for the best results with palimpsest, I would actually always advise to use more differentiation in the multispectral, in the electromagnetic spectrum. So if you, for example, we only have in infrared 850. So the radiation source is 850 nanometers, where actually it has been shown in quite a lot of examples on manuscripts and palimpsests that you better do not go too far into the infrared. A second element with palimpsests is that one of the ways to get very good differentiations and hopefully pulling out the information which is largely lost is with the application of fluorescence or luminescence effects of the faded or almost completely gone materials. So we can do that also with the dome. We have already done that, but then you have to make extra data sets. So if that question is known in advance, we can add also filters. We did not mention that during this talk, but we can add filters to the lens, and then we can also perform fluorescence and luminescence recording effects with the dome. So yes, that is possible. We didn't go very far with the multispectral dome in that field, because we are pretty much convinced that a standard so-called narrow-band multispectral imaging photographical equipment will actually deliver better results. And that's one thing, that's one part of the answer. And then secondly, of course, with the dome, you will nonetheless be able to see these, whether it is scraped away. Well, of course, these traces, how well it is scraped away, how it has been scraped away, and the consequences we can connect to that information, we will be able to image and document very well with the portable light dome system. So it is, again, as it almost always is, if you can combine it with other systems, it will be an added value. So this multi-light reflectance approach, also in palimpsest, as it is one thing on top of another and partly destroyed, partly not destroyed, that kind of three-dimensional insight, you will be able to better understand when you use this kind of technical approach. Yeah? So it is yes, no, no, yes.
Yeah, and actually we had some experience also when we came at the Girolamini, because we had the same kind of questions about how to see, to perform the microdome on the script, on the also on the vanished script, and you already answered that it depends also, and we see already that it depends on many factors, like also the reflection. You talked about the reflection, and it's very important, and that's why we have to be aware about the use of this instrument. We already we have to prepare our questions before applied the portable light dome techniques. So I don't know if Federico Ponchio maybe wants to ask something about this seminar. Federico Ponchio is a researcher at CNR, and is doing his intervention tomorrow, as already said by Hendrik. I don't know if Federico is still there. Hi, Federico.
Actually, no. I think the presentation was very, very clear and a bit out of my competence in terms of the usage of the tools, which is what most of the presentation was. On the technical details, maybe tomorrow when we may have a little bit of a discussion together about the usage and different techniques, for example, how to publish on the web and other kind of things that have a different viewpoint than research.
Okay. Thank you, Federico. I don't know if some other students or colleagues wants to put further questions about this intervention, or maybe we can also.
I have just one very quick question for about the Pixel Plus software, because you gave us two links. We can download it, or we can use it on the official site. I would like to ask you, is it possible to integrate the software in an HTML space? Of course, giving the credits to the KU11, and use it with the personal collections?
Well, that's what I already partly mentioned to Gennaro. It's at this moment, it's not really possible to really integrate it into a normal HTML environment. In theory, it is possible, but not at the moment. Not how it has been designed at this very moment. Yeah? So maybe in the future, we will work towards that solution. But at this very moment, that is not possible. Linking a data set, yes. But really, the entire viewer in an HTML, in your own HTML background, that doesn't work at the moment. Although, of course, even for that there are solutions, but then you really have to be a specialist in web design. You can put a browser environment entirely in another browser environment. So it is possible, of course, but then you need to be much more specialist in these kind of things.
Okay, thank you, Giuseppe, for the question. And I just want to say that as you have seen in the presentation, that there was one of the examples was drawn by the people of Anjou. That is a really magnificent treasure who is kept held in Leuven. And that is also a sign of the connection between Leuven and Naples, because the Bible of Anjou was made as Leif said in the 14th century in Naples by Cristoforo Romina. Is one of the master chef of Cristoforo Romina, and as a sign of this collaboration with KU Leuven, I hope that also the possibility, the chance of facsimile of this treasure could be still possible. We already start a collaboration about that after we had to interrupt that for obvious reasons, that is the virus, and I hope that we could take back this dialogue to do some further research about that, and also about the Illuminated Dante project. So if you have some other things to say, Andre can leave, or we can also.
Well, I think when you came last time to Leuven, it was just 1 week before the closing down, of course, we have worked further on the proposal, and we hope to go further when the situation will get to the new normal, and it will be a great project to collaborate and to strengthen the collaboration between Naples, different universities in Naples, and the university in Leuven. But also, of course, for the Illuminated Dante project, I think we have talked about that also, that we can go further in the collaboration and into other libraries where they have the Dante holdings and image a selection of manuscripts. We have to discuss about that. But then we really can, the possibilities and the expertise can grow and can be used on your platforms, on our platforms, and of course also in collaborations between students and researchers from both universities. I think I'm talking for the faculties, of course, but I know that Hendrik in the library is also quite willing to work and to collaborate with the microdome and the other expertise. I think international collaboration is extremely important in these new fields of doing technical linguistic, technical, and the digital humanities platform in general.
Yeah, thank you very much. And this cycle of seminars is also an open door to this kind of collaboration, because we invited not only colleagues from university, but also as intervenants, but also as attendees. We have conservators, we have librarians, so I think that all the librarians and the conservators dealing with the ancient funds that can hear and appreciate this kind of technique could also ask us or you about further collaboration. So thank you very much, Lee, for this intervention. Really beautiful and interesting intervention, and Enrico also. So we ci sentiamo, I switch to Italian, ci riaggiorniamo a domani per l'intervento di Federico Ponchio e ringrazio a tutti per aver partecipato, a tutti gli studenti, ai colleghi e ai docenti che si sono collegati anche da varie parti d'Italia e d'Europa. Grazie a tutti e arrivederci a domani per un nuovo appuntamento con il ciclo di seminari e con l'intervento di Federico Ponchio alla stessa ora, alle 9, dalle 9 alle 10.